Hello student, now this is a little awkward for me because I have never shot any video before. But as you know that we are going through a very difficult time worldwide. So we have to adopt some new technology to reach you. Previously I have uploaded some PPT slides in our Google Classroom. But many students has told me that they had some difficulties in understanding certain parts of it. So here I'm trying to explain it, whatever I sent in the Google Classroom here. Now we shall now start. I would like the camera to be focused on the page. So as you know, we shall start the module of digital control system or discrete control system. You know, digital control system is also known as discrete control system. Now, so far whatever we have studied in the control system, maybe it's in linear or non-linear, both are for the continuous signal. But you know, today's demand, today's technology demands the digitization of every system, every equipment. So we need to learn how we can apply our control theory in this digital domain. So obviously we need to adopt some different mathematical tools to explain the system, and also we need to adopt some different mathematical model of control system to control those digital system. So first, we need to understand what is digital system. Digital system, in digital system, we, in analog system, if we have a signal like this, right? So this is time axis and this is say any amplitude. So this is a continuous signal in the time domain. But in digital system, we won't have the continuous data for each and every single time. Rather, we will have some discrete values of data. So obviously, we are missing out the data in between these values. Now the question is, what is digital system and what is analog system? I would like to ask you a question that I know that you cannot answer it because I do not have that classroom format here. But let ask yourself that in our world, is it always a continuous system for you? Like you are observing a certain thing. Is the data acquired by your brain when you are observing something through your eyes are continuous? Now, if you, we all at the very first thinking, we will say that yes, it is continuous. The data that we are getting is obviously continuous through our eyes. But don't we blink? We do blink, okay? And whenever we are blinking, we are basically sampling the information which is we are getting from our eyes. Each time we are blinking, we are missing out some information, right? So it is not obvious that all the system that we think is analog is always analog. It might be digital. Now, I was giving an example of the vision, that how our vision is discrete, because we always blink, and when we blink, we miss out some information, right? Suppose someone is standing at the doorstep. Now, if I ask you to observe that person, and if I ask you, say after observing 5 minutes, if I ask you that is that person always were standing there, you would probably say yes, that person is always standing at the doorstep. But you never know, when you are blinking, at that point of time, that person may go out and come back. right? So the information you are giving me may not be always correct. So that is the problem with the digital system. We are missing out some information in the digital system. In analog system, we have a continuous signal. In digital system, we have discrete signal. And in between that discrete signal, whatever the information is, that is missing. So I would now like to... So we basically want to achieve a digital discrete values of signal like this from a analogous signal, because whatever is happening around us is analogous, but we have to send the data to our digital system in this form. So we have to somehow convert from this signal to this signal. Now how we can do that? We basically adopt a technique called sampling process. That means we take certain sample of this signal and then we will reconstitute the digitized signal from the sample data. Let us see how can we do that. Suppose this is our analog signal. Right? This is the analog signal. This is the original analog signal. This is the time axis and this is the amplitude. Okay, now I am generating a pulse train, unit pulse train. What is unit pulse train? That after a certain time period, there will be a unit pulse. So the value of this, the magnitude is unit, this is time. So there is no value in between two consecutive pulse. So we are only having some discrete pulse value at certain point of the time that depends upon the frequency of this pulse train. Okay, now this signal is known as the sampling signal and the frequency of this signal is known as the sampling frequency. Now when I'm multiplying this signal with this signal, obviously when I'm saying it's multiplication, it actually means the convolution. So when we convolute this signal with this signal, what shall we get? Now, suppose here we are having a pulse. We are starting it from zero. So obviously that pulse, this pulse is multiplied with this value, right? This value will be multiplied with this value. And what shall we get? This is one and this is having certain value. So 1 into a certain value will give the value of this, right? Similarly, here also I'm getting the value, this value. So here I'm getting this value. Now in between these two, there is always 0. So 0 into any of this value will give you 0. So obviously this into this value will give you the next sample value. Similarly for this, we will get this value. For this, we will get this value. For this, we will get this value. And ultimately we will get this, and this. That means this, then this, then this, then this. Okay, so obviously there will be another pulse train here also. As the signal is signal goes like this, your pulse train also, there will be more pulse trains like this. So you will get the other values as well. Okay, so you will get the other values. So as you can see, this is not uniform, so this, but the scale should be uniform anyway, so you can understand. Now after this convolution, this continuous signals becomes a digitized signal where we are having some discrete sample value, right? So this signal, after convolution with this signal, we are getting a signal which is only having some discrete value. So this process is known as sampling. right? So ultimately we are getting a sampled signal. Now obviously there are some missing information, like we do not know that whether this graph is like this or the graph is like this, because this information is missing. So now, but we need to reconstitute the original signal from our sampled signal, right? Now this is also very important for the digital signal, how we can reconstitute, how we can guess what is the original signal from the sampled or digital value, right? So we are having this signal, we again need to go back to the original signal. So first let us see what is the mathematical analysis of what we have seen in the last page. Okay, so the pulse train, that is delta t, you know what is delta function. So delta t can be expressed as k from minus infinity to plus infinity delta t minus kt. Now this t is the time period of the sampling system, sampling signal. So we know that sampling signal is periodic, so it must have some time period and also frequency. So this capital T is basically the time period. So if you put the k value like from minus infinity to plus infinity or from 0 to infinity, for the different k value we will get the different values of the pulse, right? So this is the pulse train, this is the equation of the pulse train, mathematical equation for the pulse train. Therefore we can write that xst, what is xst? Xs is the sampled signal, okay, and xt is the original signal. So original signal, how can I get the sample signal? Original signal multiplied with the pulse train, right? Now if I take the Fourier transform of this equation, then it should be Fourier transform of x st. You always remember this s for the sampled, okay? So this is the sampled signal or the discrete signal or digital signal. That means this is my x st, right? And this signal is basically x t, and this is delta t t. Okay, why I'm writing t here? Because the time period of this signal is t, so this time period is capital. So now that if I do the Fourier transform here, then we shall get 1 by 2 pi into f of xt convoluted with f from k minus infinity to plus infinity delta t minus kt, right? So after doing the Fourier transform, now our signal will be in the frequency domain. So this xs becomes a function of omega instead of function of t, because after Fourier transform we are basically taking our all signals from the time domain to the frequency domain, is equals to 1 by 2 pi, then x omega, we are doing the Fourier transform here. And if I do the Fourier transform of the pulse train, I from your circuit theory knowledge, you must know that it should be omega s k k is equals to minus infinity to plus infinity delta omega minus k omega s. Now, what is k omega s? Omega is the sampling frequency, right? So, this xs is equals to omega is equals to 1 by 2 pi, then 2 pi by t x omega convoluted with k is equals to minus infinity to plus infinity as usual, then delta omega k omega s. Now, why I am having this 2 pi by t? Because you know omega s is the sampling frequency and t is the time period of the sampling signal. So, obviously omega s should be equals to 2 pi by capital T. So, then xs omega is basically 1 by t x omega minus k omega s. Now, this is nothing but the mathematical analysis of what we have done in the last page. We have graphically explained that what was happening in the sampling process, and this is the mathematic analysis of the sample process. So we have just seen what is the sampling process and what is the mathematical analysis of the sampling process. Now we shall start with Shannon sampling theorem. Now, what the question, the fundamental question is, what should be the frequency of the sampling signal? We have seen, we have considered the frequency of the sampling signal as omega s, and the time period of the sampling signal is capital T. But can we choose any frequency for the sampling signal? That is the question. Or if not, then what should be the frequency of the sampling signal? Now, to understand that, let us go back to our previous example. The example I actually told you at the at the beginning of the class, that suppose I am asking you to observe a person at the doorstep, and you are looking at that person. Then I come back after 5 minutes and ask you whether the person was there or not. You will say the person is there, but you never know that when you are blinking in between that, the person may go out and come back. Right. So, the information is missing. Now, how can we overcome this problem? Now, you will probably tell me that, no sir, that cannot happen because my blinking frequency is so high, or the time period when I just closed my eyes is so small that it is not possible for a person to go back, to go and come back in that very short duration of time. That means you are having a kind of condition on your sampling time. Without that, it is not proper, right? So here also we shall explain this, what should be your sampling frequency and what should be your sampling time, in graph in this way. Okay, so suppose our original signal is having the maximum frequency, which is omega m. Okay, now if I take a Fourier transform of the signal, it will be something like this. Some people show it with triangle, you can also show it with triangle or circle. So this is your obviously omega m, and this is minus omega m, right? Now suppose I'm taking a sample frequency, which is say omega s. Okay, so the sample frequency will have another Fourier analysis. I mean, after doing the Fourier analysis, we will have another spectrum of this sample frequency, right? So this sample frequency is say omega s. Now in this picture, this is the frequency omega, this is the magnitude x. Now in this figure, it is clearly we can see that if this is the case, then we cannot filter out the original signal from the sample frequency, because there are some overlapping, right? So due to this overlapping, it is actually not possible to filter out the original signal from the sample signal, right? So when we need to go back to the original signal from the sample signal, we need to filter out the sample frequency. Now this is not going to happen in this case. When can it happen? It can only happen in this case. Suppose this is omega m, this is minus omega m. Right? So this is fs omega s and this is omega s. Then you can see we can easily take a filter and filter out the original signal. Now what is the condition that we can get from here? That omega s should be greater than or is equals to 2 into omega m. If this is not maintained, then we will reach there. And if it is maintained, then we can reach here. From here, we can easily filter out the original signal. In this case, we cannot filter out the original signal. Now, so the condition for my sampling frequency is must be greater than twice of the maximum of the original signal frequency. If the original signal is have the maximum frequency component, which is omega n, your sampling frequency must be greater than that, or at least equal to that, twice of this omega m, okay, or greater than twice of the omega m.